Good morning, everyone. I, Smriti Paranspe, on behalf of NatureWalk Charitable Trust and APCCF Wildlife West, welcome you to our fourth session, The Fascinating World of Queenless Ants. Our today's speaker is a very interesting person, Mrs. Nutan Karnik. Ma'am, I welcome you. Ma'am has done her master's in zoology from Pune University, and her specialization subject is genetics. Very interesting. And currently she is pursuing she is working as a project assistant in Center for Ecological Service Sciences in the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. And she has a very close association with NatureWalk, and she has been working with NatureWalk, and we are going with her to many nature orientation camps, and she has been working with the renowned ornithologist of Pune, Mr. Kiran Purandare. So she has a very, very close association with NatureWalk. So ma'am, I hand over the session to you. So thank you
Smriti for the very warm welcome. And thank you, Anuj, and your entire team for inviting me here today to talk on ants. Thank you all for giving your Sunday morning to listen to me today. Basically, I work with Professor Raghavendra Gadakkar in the Department of Center for Ecological Sciences in Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. In my department, people work on the ecology, evolution, and behavior of a variety of animals in a scientific way. So in our department, our group, that is Professor Raghavendra Gadakkar's group, specializes in the study of social insects like ants, bees, and wasps. And I have been working on ants for past many years in this group. So now when we talk about ants, many people tell me that we know only two types of ants, red ants and black ants. But that's not the case. In fact, there are close to 13,000 species of ants in the world, like known species of ants in the world. And they show amazing variety in the way they behave, in the way they look, or in the way they make their nest, in the way they forage, or they navigate with each other and communicate with each other, and so on and so forth. So for example, there are weaver ants. Who use the silk secreted by their own larvae to make a nest. They stitch leaves together and make a nest. Then there are jumping ants from India who can jump as long as 20 centimeters to attack a prey or to escape from the predator. Then there are leafcutter ants who grow elaborate fungal gardens and maintain them in a very sophisticated way. There are also slave-making ants who raid other ant colonies and capture the workers there, bring them back to their own colony, and use them as a ready-made worker force. So there are like millions of such interesting facts about all different kinds of ants. So today for this talk, I am going to talk about the queenless ants. Just 1 minute, let me go to my presentation. Yeah, can you see my slide?
Nutan, kindly share the screen.
Okay, just 1 minute.
Yes.
Okay, now is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
I hope it is visible to everybody. Just put it in the chat box.
Is it all right? Can you see?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, sorry for that. Today I'm going to talk about queenless ants. Now, what is this term queenless? In many ant species, there is an individual whom we call as a queen who looks bigger and slightly different than the rest of the workers. And she is also the individual who lays eggs in the colony. Other ants act as workers, and they never lay eggs in this queen's presence. Now in queenless ants also, there is only one individual who lays eggs, but she doesn't look like a queen in the traditional sense. So this individual looks exactly the same like the rest of the workers, but still she is the only one individual in the colony who lays eggs and maintains reproductive monopoly. In her presence, other individuals will never lay eggs. So now there is no size difference between this egg layer and the rest of the workers. Anu, just 1 minute, give me a second. Yeah. So now to differentiate this individual from a typical queen in other ants, we call this individual as gamergate. So gamergate is nothing but a mated egg laying worker. And the gamergate is the only one individual who lays eggs. Now these queenless ants are eusocial ants or truly social ants. Now what is the meaning of eusocial? Usually eusociality is defined by three characters. First, cooperative brood care. So in a nest, all the ants come together and they take care of the brood, that is eggs, larva and pupa. Then at any given point of time, you will see different generations coexisting in a colony. And then there is also division, reproductive division of labor, where only the queen lays eggs and rest of the ants work for the colony. Now these queenless ants are also a type of primitive ants who show primitive characters, like queen and workers look alike and they have small colonies. The egg laying rate of the queen is also small and these colonies consist of a few hundreds of workers. Also here the foragers hunt solitarily. Now this queenless ant system poses some very important and interesting questions. For example, why is it that in some ants they have queens and in some ants they don't have queens? Or how the system functions, or how the colony functions in queenless ants, or how do the gamergates get chosen here? So there are a lot of questions like this. Especially here, the first question, how in some ants, why in some ants there is a queen and in some ants there is no queen? Such type of questions are evolutionary important questions. I won't talk about them in my talk today, and it's not possible to cover everything in one session. Instead, I will try to give you a flavor of research done related to colony dynamics. And I also hope that by the end of my talk today, you will be able to appreciate how ant research is done in the field of animal behavior and how it takes years of painstakingly gather the data and the science behind this process. We work on a genus of queenless ants called Dichoma. Here I am showing you a typical composition of a Dichoma colony. So here on the top left, you will see a photo of Dichoma male and below it, there is a photo of Dichoma female. So they look very different from each other. Males are reddish brown in color. They have wings and they have long antenna. Whereas females are dark black in color and they don't have wings. So as I told you before, the gamergate lays eggs. And in the middle photo, you will see that these ants are holding eggs in their mouth. Now these eggs will get converted or developed into a larva. And then larva spins a covering around its body. It wrinkles its body and then gets transformed into a cocoon. Now these cocoons are brown in color. And from this cocoon, adult ant will emerge. Now, when I'm explaining all these things to you, it won't even take a minute, but it takes a really long time to understand all these life stages of the development. For example, how much time it takes for an egg to develop into larva and larva into pupa and pupa into adult. In fact, we have measured literally hundreds of Dichoma ants under microscope. And we had selected 10 different body parameters and we have measured each and every ant for these 10 different body parameters just to see how different the workers look from or measure from each other. Now you will think why all these studies are important. So these studies are important from a taxonomical point of view. Now taxonomy is a science where identify and classify and name the organism based on its body characters. Now, in case of ants, such classification is very important because it helps us to identify the ants in our field, in the field. In fact, we routinely take the students of IISc for ant walk And the idea behind this ant walk is that you just identify and note down all the ants as you walk across the way. And once you have all this information in hand, you can ask many interesting questions. Like, how is the ant diversity on IIC campus? And if you have this data collected over a long period of time, then you can also check how this diversity changes from time to time. So you can do many different things with this data collected in this way. Now I will tell you how the dichoma nest looks like. So these ants make nest in a very peculiar way. They have a elevated mound on the ground and they decorate it with dried sticks. Sometimes they also use bird feathers or dead spider molds or colorful petals. Now in the center foot, now you must be thinking, why do they decorate the nest with all these different things? If you look at the center photo, you will see an ant which is drinking water from the which has accumulated on the feather. This photo is taken in Bangalore by scientist Mark Moffett, and he observed that these ants use these decorations to accumulate the morning dew. So especially in summer, it's very useful if you have a ready-made source of water near your nest entrance. So now let's switch the gears here and we will understand how the colony functions. Now in dichoma colony, there is a division of labor. Among the workers. So basically all the young workers in the colony tends to stay inside the nest and they take care of the brood, that is the eggs, larva and pupa. And they are also engaged in nest maintenance activities, like they clean the nest, they repair the damaged nest, or they guard the nest. And then there is a group of workers who are older individuals and who go outside of the colony and they collect food. So such individuals are called foragers. Now dichoma ants feed on grasshoppers, termites, small cockroaches and small insects. And these foragers are diurnal foragers, meaning they are active throughout the day. They also hunt solitarily. So when they go out, they catch a prey, sting the prey and paralyzes it and then brings it back to the colony. Sometimes the prey is bigger in size compared to them, but still they somehow manage to drag the prey near the colony entrance, and then some workers come out and help the forager to take it inside the colony. So now, how do you establish all these facts scientifically? Just 1 minute, let me take a break here. So we chose to work on a species of dichoma called dichoma silonins. So these dichoma silonins ants are found in India and in Sri Lanka, and they are also easily available in and around Bangalore. They are in fact very much present on our IIC campus. So we decided to do a long-term study on these dichoma silonins ants, and we chose some 26 ant colonies and we monitored them for 1 year. So this was quite an extensive study. Now let me tell you two of the many important results that came out of this study. What we did is that we marked and monitored the foragers of coming out of all these colonies. Now what we did is that over a period of 3 days, we kept on continuously marking every forager that was coming out of the colony. And then at the end, on fourth day, we dug all these colonies and counted how many marked individuals are present in the colony. And very interestingly, we found that and it was also expected that as the colony size increased, the number of foragers also increased. But more than that, every colony appointed approximately 24% of foragers for this foraging task. And this proportion was quite consistent across the colonies. By doing this simple experiment, we could conclude that if you want to estimate the size of a colony, you don't have to dig the colony every time. What you have to do is just simply go out in the field and count, and whatever foragers are out in the field, you have to just count them, and then you will know the entire colony size. then we were also interested to know if the foragers are, if they choose a particular direction when they go out of the colony in search of food. So what we did is that we marked the compass directions of all the foragers that were stepping out of the colony in search of food over multiple days. And after doing statistical analysis on this data, we found two interesting things. First is that foragers showed directional fidelity, that every forager preferred a certain specific direction. But in as a group, they were covering all possible directions. So the colony basically was sending the foragers in all possible directions. Now, how do the ants achieve this mechanism is really not known. It's poorly understood. Now not all the studies can be done by studying the ants in the field. For some kind of questions, you have to literally see what is going on inside the colony. Can you see my slide? Excuse me, please give me a minute.
Yes.
It is visible.
It's a plain orange color slide.
Yeah, but it's not. I mean, I don't know what is happening. Please give me a minute.
Yeah.
Presentation mode मध्ये जाण्याची ऐवजी
Yes, is it visible now, Nutan?
Okay.
It's visible now.
Okay. Let me go to the presentation mode. I will just try it out. If that problem should not happen again,
you can keep it like that. If it's creating a problem, you can keep it like this.
No, just let me check. Yes, now it's fine. Is it okay with you?
Yeah.
I'm really sorry for that. So what I was telling you is that not all the questions can be answered by just looking at the ants in the field. For some questions, you have to literally dig the entire colony from the field and bring it to the lab, and then only you can see what is happening inside the colony. Now, how do we study them? So what we do first is that we go out in the field and then look at one ant nest. Then we start digging the nest. Usually dichoma nests are 2 to 3 feet deep and they have 3 to 4 chambers which are interconnected. Typically we find that guard ants along with few males are sitting in the topmost chamber, and the rest of the workers along with the brood are sitting in the chambers below. Now these ants also have a separate dirt chamber at the end of the colony where they dump all kinds of waste material. Now as we start opening these chambers, you see here you can see one such chamber where all the cocoons are neatly kept. We have to take care not to lose any single individual, because in the field we don't know who the gamergate is and who the worker is, because all of them look alike, and it's the gamergate is very precious for the colony, so we can't afford to lose the gamergate. So carefully we have to pick up each and every individual along with their entire boards, and sometimes this process takes even 3 to 4 hours. Then we bring them back to the lab. And in the lab, we make this artificial plaster of Paris nests. So basically we make different chambers in the tray and we keep glass plates on top of it for easy observation. And then we release all these ants there. We also keep them in constant temperature and humidity. And we give them termites and grasshoppers to feed on. So basically we are trying to mimic here their natural condition as much as possible. Then what do we do is that now we need to identify each and every ant, right? So we mark every ant with different color codes on their body. So these color paints are non-toxic and quick drying, We use different kinds of combinations. So sometimes we use single colors, sometimes we use double colors, and sometimes we use triple colors. So like this, we can literally mark hundreds of ants. So at the end, now we have a colony where the all the ants are marked, and also we have to keep on observing this colony till we find one individual who is laying eggs. That is the only way to identify the gametogate. So at the end, we have a colony where the gametogate is marked and ready, and all the individuals are ready for observation. Now, our lab has developed one elaborate ethogram or a behavioral code list by which we can identify each and every behavior. So it is done in a very scientific way. So when we observe ants, two ants, like when they are interacting with each other, we have a distinct behavior code for each behavior. And we write down all these behaviors, and later on we subject this data to different kinds of analysis. Now, what is so special about these ants? So Dichama is the only genus in the world where these ants have a pair of small wing buds on the thorax. And I will show you the photos. On the left hand side, you can see the Jema is here. So this is just to show you the position of Jema. It is situated on the thorax just behind the head, and on the right hand side you can see the Jema more clearly. It is red in color and it looks like a jewel. That's why the name is Jema. Now, what is even more remarkable is that only the ants who possess this Jema have the ability to attract males, mate with them, and lay eggs. So what happens in most of the known species of this genus Dichama is that the gametogate actively mutilates the Jema of all the newborn individuals in her colony. Now here what happens is that when a ant encloses from her cocoon in the colony, or when there is a newborn present in the colony, there is a small group of workers who just go and hold captive that newborn individual. Then the gametogate comes, and with her mandible, she simply pulls out the Jema from the newborn's body. Now the Jema are connected to the central nervous system. And as soon as the Jema mutilation is done, this newborn undergoes some kind of irreversible neurophysiological changes in her body, because of which she becomes sexually unattractive. She loses her capacity to mate and attract males, and she can never lay eggs. So like this, the gametogate ensures that in her presence, no worker is capable of laying eggs in the colony, and she is the sole egg there. And also these workers who are already mutilated don't have any choice but to just keep working for the colony. Now we study this Dichama sullenense, which is a typical of this mutilating ant species, where the gametogate mutilates all the workers in the colony. Now there is another population of Dichama from the foothills of the Nilgiri mountains in southern India, where the gametogate does not mutilate the workers. Now for time being, let's call this population as Dichama Nilgiri. Now Dichama Nilgiri looks almost the same as Dichama sullenense. Only difference is that there is this huge shift in the behavior, that in Dichama sullenense the gametogate mutilates the workers, but in Dichama Nilgiri gametogate never mutilates. And also in Nilgiri, even though every worker is bearing the Jema and every worker has an equal chance to reproduce, they never do so in the presence of the gametogate. So this made us wondering, like, what is the trigger of mutilation here? I mean, why is it that it doesn't happen in Nilgiri? So it's very interesting, and my lab did a very interesting and simple experiment. What we did is that we took some cocoons from Dichama sullenense and some cocoons or pupa from Dichama Nilgiri, and we simply exchanged these cocoons between these two, sullenense and Nilgiri. So basically, you just take few cocoons from sullenense colony and keep them inside Nilgiri colony, and then take some cocoons from Nilgiri colony and release them in sullenense colony, and then see what happens next. So interestingly, what we found is that when Nilgiri callos eclose in the sullenense colony, sullenense gametogate did not mutilate them. So mutilation did not happen. Whereas when sullenense callos eclosed in Nilgiri colony, Nilgiri gametogate mutilated them. So earlier we were thinking, if the gametogates are different here or the workers are different here. Like, is it possible that the sullenense gametogate knows how to mutilate and Nilgiri gametogate doesn't know how to mutilate? But that's not the case here. Even the Nilgiri grammar gate knows how to mutilate the workers, but she never do so in case of her own workers. So here basically what is happening is that these grammar gates are responding to the signal that is coming out of the workers, presumably from their JEMA, and they are simply responding to that signal. So here the grammar gates are similar, but the workers are different. And this experiment shows that cues for mutilation originate in the victims. Now we have also seen that when the grammar gate begins her career as a future reproductive, what happens is that initially she is very aggressive towards her workers, and then once she mates and starts laying eggs, slowly her dominance comes down, and she switches from physical dominance to chemical signal. Now how do the workers know that who is the grammar gate in the colony, and how do they acknowledge her presence? Now in social insects, it's widely known fact that they have certain types of chemicals on their body or on their cuticle, which are called as cuticular hydrocarbons. And these chemicals are responsible for passing on various kinds of information among the ants. What we did is that in Dichama sironins, we did the analysis of these cuticular hydrocarbons. And what we found is that we analyzed different compounds. And what we found is that through these cuticular hydrocarbons, the ants can assess each other's sex, age, colony membership, and fertility level. So when they touch each other, they will know with, if the opposite ant is a male or female, and they will know her relative age and whether that ant belongs to their own colony or to a different colony, and also her fertility level. In fact, after mating, the grammar gate's chemical profile also changes from the profile of a virgin sterile worker to that of a mated egg-laying grammar gate. And workers also kind of sense the change in the profile of the grammar gate, and they respond to it. They become submissive and they remain in her control. Now, not all the ants use such kind of chemical communication. There is a species of finless ants called Dichama indicum, which uses a very different kind of communication. It's very interesting. So it's a simple form of communication called tandem running. Now, what is tandem running? So tandem running is a behavior when one ant follows the other ant by keeping in very close proximity of her. Now here in this picture, you can see that the ant on the right hand side is the leader ant, and there is an ant carrying a pupa in her mouth is a follower ant. So this behavior is very useful when the ants need to relocate their colony. Sometimes what happens is that these colonies get damaged by human disturbance, or then there are various environmental factors responsible. So in such cases, these ants have to really relocate the entire colony along with the brood to a safe site. Now suddenly there is a colony which is exposed to outside environment. Then there is a threat from predators and thieves. It is also observed that many times when the colony is undergoing relocation, the other Dichama indicum ants from neighboring colonies come there and they try to steal the pupa from this colony. Then they just steal the pupa and then they take them back to their own colony, let them enclose there, and like this they will get a ready-made workforce to work for them without investing anything. So that's a pretty chaotic situation when the colony is undergoing a relocation. And it's found that usually less than 1/5 of the ants in such colonies are tandem leaders. Now, these leaders have a big responsibility of keeping the colony safe. So whenever relocation happens, these leaders, they always try to keep all the colony together in one place. They keep on communicating among themselves. And these are the ants who decide on the which is the best safe place to move the colony. And also they try to choose the shortest possible path because they wanted to reach the destination quicker. So this whole colony relocation behavior, it looks very simple, but there is a complex process behind it, and it involves multiple factors. One of our former student, Dr. Sumana from ICER Kolkata, has done a lot of research on this colony relocation process, and they are still investigating lots of aspects behind this process. I think now I would like to stop here. I feel that I have given you quite a glimpse of the world of ants, and whatever I have talked today in this on this topic is based on many years of work from multiple people research, and I have listed all of them here. So at this point of time, I can take any questions if you have. I will be happy to answer them.
Nutan, there is one question which somebody has put on my WhatsApp. Is can you tell some facts, maybe some interesting facts about ants?
Okay.
Basic facts.
Okay. So basic facts about ants. So ants are basically social insects, and they have a variety of ways in which the colony is organized. So some ants have queens, some ants have gametes. Now in some ant colonies there is also a queen and a gamete. Then they have very interesting ways in which they build a nest. So Anu, just give me a minute. Again, this orange screen is coming.
Okay.
Let me check what is happening. Okay, is it fine now?
Yes.
Okay. So, So these ants they make a nest in a variety of ways. Let me take example of one weaver ant called Ecophylla smaragdina, which is available in India, and they have a very interesting way of building the nest. What they do is that the foragers basically they pull together leaves, big leaves of the tree. They build nest on the top of the tree. So these foragers pull different leaves together, and then they hold their larva in their mouth, and they force the larva to secrete some silk from its body. Now this larva, instead of weaving a cocoon for itself, it behaves altruistically. It donates the silk for the colony, and these ants hold a larva in their mouth, and they just go on stitching these leaves together with the silk which is secreted from the larva. And in this way, they form the nest. So this is a very interesting fact about Ecophylla.
Ma'am, there's another question. The question is, could you please give more information about ant counting methodology?
Ant counting?
Methodology.
Okay. So what we do is that once we get all the ants in the lab, we basically manually count each and every ant. Okay. And we also mark them, as I told you, we mark them with different color codes. There are three different parts on the ant's body. First is head, then second is thorax and abdomen. Okay. So we mark these ants on these three different places, and we use a combination of color codes. You can also use a counter, which is easily available in the market, and just simply manually count all the ants that you find.
Okay.
Is it okay, or do you need more information?
No, I think it's okay. There is one more question. Does spotting of colors on ants affect them?
No. As I told you that these colors are non-toxic and quick dry. In fact, these ants keep on grooming each other, and in the process of grooming, they keep on removing this color. So we have to keep on marking them back again and again.
Okay, thank you.
It doesn't affect their behavior.
Okay, there is one more question. How many ants can be there in a single colony?
Approximately there are 300 to 400 ants inside a dicamba colony. But it also depends upon the species. Like some ants have thousands of ants in the colony. So in this system, dicamba system, usually the colony size is very small. Just a few hundred individuals are present.
There's another question. Where is the CHC secreted in the ant's body?
So CHC is secreted it is present throughout the cuticle on the ant's body.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, there are a few more questions. Methodology. Yeah. Are there any indigenous ants found in Western Ghats, especially in Maharashtra region?
Indigenous ants. Okay. Right now, I don't recollect this information. Maybe can I get back to you offline?
Yes, that is possible. You can send an email and okay. which we can share to these people.
Okay, okay. Sure.
Okay, there is one interesting question. What two types of ants are called that we see in our houses? One is like black and another is red. So is okay. there any common name for that?
If you can send me a photo, maybe I will be able to tell you about these ants, because there is a variety of red ants and a variety of black ants. There are multiple species involved in that.
Okay.
Ma'am, there's another question. Okay. What is the difference between Dichama salonis and
Dichama nilgiri victims? So the main difference is that Dichama salonis, if I give you two ants, one is Dichama salonis and one is Dichama nilgiri, you will find that the Dichama salonis workers will not have JEMA on her body, whereas Dichama nilgiri worker has the JEMA on her body.
Okay.
So that is the main difference.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, can you just share your email ID? We will put in our chat box.
Okay, so can I just type a message here?
Yeah, you just mentioned it.
I'm doing that. Yeah, done. Just 1 minute. I think it is done privately.
Yeah. No, you can tell us. We will put it.
It's simple. It's nutan.karnik@gmail.com. nutan.karnik@gmail.com.
Okay, one more question. In Pune urban location, how many types of ants are roughly found? Any idea?
No, I don't have any idea. Maybe we will have to check the reports. I can do that and get back to you.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much, Nutan. It was a very interesting session.
My pleasure, Anuj. Thank you so much.
I would request Harshada to extend a vote of thanks. Over to you, Harshada. Harshada, you will have to unmute yourself. Yeah, Harshada. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us for today's session. And that ants seem to be pretty tiny and small creatures, but they do play a significant role.
Yes.
Really happy that like for subject like ants, we got a good number of participants, because usually it's kind of, they are a mess, they don't help out much. We always get them as if we need to like either kill them or we don't need them in the house. But thank you so much for this insightful session. And we are looking forward to many more sessions with you.
Sure.
And there are certain requests in the chat box about, can you please share your PPT? So I would rather suggest all the participants that please send us an email and we will forward your doubts to ma'am. So that ma'am be saying that you can solve the doubts and get back to us.
Sure, I will do that.
Okay.
In fact, I can also point interested people to various interesting sites on ants.
Yeah.
Or various books that they can read on ants.
Yeah. And also to all our participants, a very, very thank you. We are grateful that you joined us on this Sunday. And today, I think it's quite a significant day because we are having the solar eclipse going on. We also have the International Yoga Day today. We also have Father's Day and maybe celebrated ants as well. And for the upcoming programs, which are going to be conducted by Nature Walk Charitable Trust, Please get back to us, or also you can check out our newly launched website, www.naturewalktrust.org. And also in the chat box, I have pasted certain links from our for our Facebook page and Instagram page, and also Wildlife Forum, which we have created over WhatsApp. So you all can definitely join in that, and we will be solving all your doubts related to wildlife environment, and we would try to you to connect to maximum of experts. And also, last but not the least, I don't know because I couldn't join during the introduction, but today a very, very specific day or specific event about today's date is also all over the world, World Climate Day, Change Day is being celebrated. And I guess like as a part of Earthlings or as a part of environment, we should all take this very, very seriously, and let's work towards conservation and preservation of environment. And let's keep in mind that climate is changing. When will we change? On that note, thank you so much for joining.
Thank you.
If you have anything to tell us, to any query, just to say hi, send us an email on naturewalkoffice@gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Nutan.
Thank you. Bye, Anuj.